Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Wow. Good morning and welcome to Witten on this beautiful summer's day. It's lovely out there. Bit of a breeze, but it's lovely. But welcome into God's house this morning as we come before his throne and praise and worship his name. To those of you online, you should be online today, hopefully. All is going well. Thank you, David and Robin, for all you've done this morning. Good morning to all of you on catch up as well. Hope that the service will be a blessing to you. You should have received your notice sheet as you came in, just to go through the items again. On Tuesday, there is no prayer meeting here, but there is a united prayer meeting at Summerton Baptist Church. If you don't know where that is, please have a word with Robin. I think he's going to do some little maps, because it's a little bit out in the sticks, but a lovely little village. Okay. On Wednesday, we have the community cafe, and then in the evening, it is the ladies' friendship group. If you haven't signed up for the button craft, please still come along, even though you may not be able to do the craft. Please come and have a cup of coffee and a chat. Don't feel as if you're on your own. We're there to bond and have friendship, so please come along to that. Thursday, the 2 o'clock prayer meeting here, and at 7:45, there is a life group, and it's at Sarah's house this week. And I've got a little note from Ray. He said, read Genesis chapters 2 and 3. That's your homework ready for Thursday. The next Sunday, we have our morning worship, which will include communion, and our speaker will be Pastor Cole. Please remember those who are unwell. We do pray particularly for Val this morning, who's been readmitted to hospital. So please pray for her, Val. I hope you're watching. If you're not, you're watching on catch up. We are praying. We will keep praying. We love you, and we'll keep praying for you to get well. Please pray for Beverly as well. She's not so good at the moment. Please pray for her. She's not feeling so good. So please remember her in all your prayers. I think that's it for this morning. Cole, did you have a good Sunday off? Did. Well, it's good to have you back. So I will hand over the service to our pastor. And thank you.
Is that? Ah, right, okay. So when it's flashing green, it means it's on mute. When it's no solid green, it means it's... Okay, there we are. We live and learn. We'll be getting lots of things like this over the next few weeks. And those online, next week you'll be seeing me in high definition. Not a good experience, I can guarantee you. But at least you'll be able to see things clearly. Hopefully they're going to come in on Tuesday and Wednesday this week to finish off the installation and particularly focus on the computer, replacing the computer, make it very good for those online. It does sound better, doesn't it? It sounds a lot clearer, which it should do. Hopefully, when we get the new screen in and everything next week, it will be even better, all singing and dancing. Just to say, we've still got this hanging around. This was found in the garden after the coronation celebration. Does this belong to anyone? If not, we'll probably put it in a second-hand shop. Doesn't belong to anyone here. Anyone online? Okay. Anyone fancy it, then please come and see me afterwards. It's going free. It's sitting here. I don't think it's genuine silver, but it looks very nice if you're into that kind of thing. It's a children's family service today, so we're looking at a different theme, and today's theme for our service is true wisdom. True wisdom. And we're going to start by reading from Psalm 14. Psalm 14, verses 1 to 4. Here the psalmist writes, "That man is a fool who says to himself, 'There is no God.' Anyone who talks like that is warped and evil and cannot really be a good person at all. The Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who are wise, who wants to please God. But no, all have stayed away. All are rotten with sin. No one is good, not one. They eat my people like bread, and wouldn't think of praying, don't they really know any better? Let's stand and sing our first hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Please take your seats. Let's keep our eyes shut. Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Father, we thank you we can come before you today. We can come before you, the immortal, invisible, only wise God, but the one who chose to reveal himself in his Son, Jesus, who came to earth and displayed the beauty of your nature, the beauty of your heart, your love and your intentions towards humankind. One who showed great restraint and love, even given our willfulness and our rebellion towards you, offering us a new way, a holy way, a different way. Not man's way, not through trying to be good, through actions that only reach our hands and our feet and not our hearts. Would you offer us a new way? A new righteousness, not our righteousness, but a righteousness that comes from you, Father, from your Holy Son, showing us that we can't do it by ourselves. The law doesn't work. We can't keep the law, but you, Lord, died in our place, paying the price of our failings and our sin to put us right, and then giving us your Spirit to sanctify and to change and to make us better, not just on the outside, but on the inside, transformed by your presence, by your Spirit, by your life living inside us. Father God, we come before you with thanksgiving this morning, but also perhaps, Father, with a sense of failing, because during this week we've let you down, because we haven't lived up to our Christian profession, because at times we haven't declared you in our voices or in our actions. And we ask again for your forgiveness. And we ask you, Father God, to send your Spirit upon us, this church here in Witten, upon each one of us, to restore and to refresh, to forgive and to bless, and to make us a blessing. Father, help us to be more like you. Help us to reflect that love and that goodness, that patience, that restraint. Help us, Lord, to reflect the Lord Jesus in our lives. That others may see and wonder, there's something different about that person. Not to praise us, not so we can pat our backs and say, I did good, but so we can lift our hands and say, thank you, Jesus. So we can point to you, Lord Jesus, and say that you are the way. You are the truth. You are the light. Father God, we just pray you may bless this time. Be with each one of us here. Be with all our friends online, those watching live and watching later on. Holy Spirit, mix and move amongst us. Bring your, glorify your name in our lives and in the life of this church. Lord Jesus, work in our hearts and lift our eyes to you today. And as we look at truth, Lord, may we see your truth and become confident in your truth and become confident in your wisdom. Lord, bless this time. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Sunday. We call it Sunday. The Jews call it Sabbath. Sabbat, which means, who knows what that means? Any young people know what Sabbat means? Anyone knows what it means? Any ideas? Rest, it is rest, it's the idea. Literally, it means to cease, to stop, in order to rest. A Sabbat is a different day to all the other days. And we get quite confused because we think of it as a holy day. We get worried about holy days. But holy days are important. We've just had a bank holy day. Now, for most people, the only holy part about it was different to the other days of the week, for some of them. Holy day is a day that is different, a day set aside for a different purpose. And Sunday is a holy day. It's a day of rest, a time for us to take it out and to think about the Lord and to do different things. And that can be simply sit in the garden this afternoon and just enjoying the beauty of creation and giving thanks to God. It can be enjoying the beauty of the earth that God has given us. Or it can be doing some other hobby or thing that you enjoy doing, going for a walk perhaps, going down to the beach or something like that. It's a time, but when you're in that time, you're conscious of God's goodness and the fact you've got this day off, because in days gone by, people had to work Sundays. That's why we have, traditionally, two services in the UK. This morning service was for the gentry, you know, the people who could afford to take the time off, and the evening service was for the working classes who had normally to work on Sunday. And the reason it was at 6:30 was because that was after the milking hours. You know, the cows have been milked, everything's been done, they can lock up the sheds and what have you, and finally the working class people can go to chapel on Sunday evening or evensong if they're Anglican. Rest is a real blessing, and I was really pleased last Sunday to get a Sunday off, because actually it really did me a world of good. And on Monday I was walking with the dog and I felt God really speak to me powerfully about next year's children's mission. And often when I'm out walking, I'm thinking and I'm praying, and God's giving me ideas for sermons and children's talks. On that one walk I got the theme for the children's talk and six stories. I've never had it before. Six whole stories with the ideas, the characters, came flooding into my mind, and I was thinking, I need some way of recording it, so I had to kind of work out a way of memorizing the different characters. And when I got home, I wrote them all down, and I'm starting to develop those stories now. Rest is important. Rest enables you to hear. So take this time, see Sunday as a day of rest, a time to reflect, a time to look upwards, to give the time to hear God speak. Because when you're expecting God to speak, you're more likely to be ready when he does. be expectant, look up. So we're going to do that now by singing a series of songs. The first one takes one of the themes from the previous hymn we've just sung and reminds us that God is the Ancient of Days.
trusting in your blood, and Lord of faithfulness, for your power back in me is changing me.
Please take your seats. And we're going to come to our memory verse. I hope you've been keeping up your memory verses. Anyone remember what number we are this particular Sunday? What number are we? I said that our last one, the clue was, our last one was John 14, verse 6. Anyone have any idea where we could be this time? Seven, that's right, seven. So Patrick, my slides, please, thank you. Let's see if everyone can remember what they are. Anyone remember the very first one? Any boys and girls remember? Sword rule number one? Peter, okay. All right, this is the new.
You shall keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is steadfast on him, because he trusts in you.
Right, let's have a look. Brilliant. Remember the verse? No, okay. So, well done. Isaiah 26, verse 3. Brilliant, well done. You will keep in perfect peace whose mind are steadfast because they trust in you. What about sword rule number 2? Anyone remember that one? I'll give a quick flash there. Very easy one. It's a great one. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. Okay. There you go, Peter.
Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so the man of God can be thoroughly equipped. Every good
words. Well done, that's right, well done. Excellent, right, sword drill 3. Anyone have any idea which that could be? I'll flash it on the screen again very quickly. Well, that's an easy one, isn't it? Okay, Abby.
The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law.
Brilliant. Well done. Well done. Galatians. That shouldn't be 22. There's not 22 chapters in Galatians. That should be 2, verse 23. I need to correct that. 5. 5 equals it. But yeah, that's right. It's 22, 23. 5. Anyway, right. Okay. 4. Jesus said... Okay, oh, Tom's won, okay. Tom's gonna pass it to Tom.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, verse 6.
Brilliant, well done, thank you. Oh, you've done the next one, you've done 5, but that's exactly right. It's 6. You've done it right, you've done 6. We're ahead of the game, but you're right, that's John 6. So we need 4. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Anyone knows that reference? Well done. John 8, verse 12. Brilliant. Well done. And number 5, quotation from Hebrews. Anyone know? Okay. Abby again.
Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Brilliant. That's great. We can rely. We can rely on Jesus because he never changes. It's the same every day. Hebrews 13, verse 8. And finally, the one that Tom did, which is brilliant. Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So these are all critical verses, really important verses for us to understand. All important verses for us to understand. And the next one is also very important because it takes us right back to the beginning. And if it's going to take us right back to the beginning, what book do you think it's going to be in? Yes, Peter? Genesis, that's right. And right at the beginning, what chapter do you think it will be in? Chapter 1, that's right. So this is going to be based in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27. Any biblical scholars here can tell me what Genesis 1 verse 27 is without looking it up. Okay. No, it's a good try. That's Genesis 1:1. It's a brilliant try, Jason, but it's not exactly. But it's exactly right. That's a great verse. I was thinking of doing that one, but we thought we'd do this one here because I think this one's particularly relevant to today's society. So, right, here we are. A bit of a clue for later on. Okay, sword drill 7. Seventh one is this. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. male and female he created them. Okay, so we're going to memorize this verse, a really important verse. Okay, so we start off by memorizing the first bit. Say it all together three times. So God created mankind in his own image. And again. So God created mankind in his own image. And again. So God created mankind in his own image. Then we add the next section, which is, in the image of God, he created them. In the image of God, he created them. In the image of God, he created them. And finally, we add the final element, which is, male and female, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Male and female, he created them. So we put them all together, and it's this. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Genesis 1, verse 27. Okay, it's number 7. Now, the next month in July, I'll provide you a sheet of paper with the 8 of them, because we'll be doing the test in the late part of the year, probably in December. We'll do a special competition, and then I'll let you know in the September what the prizes are. The top prize, though, is really, really exciting, and I'll let you know that later on when I've approved the budget with the leaders of the church. Okay. This is really important, memorizing scripture, putting scripture between your ears so that you can reflect. Because remember when Jesus was being tempted in the desert, how he responded to every temptation with a quotation. He remembered scripture and fired back scripture as a response. And we need to understand scripture right between our mind, in our mind, so it's there. And we can recall scripture. It's less important actually understanding where it's from sometimes. That's very, very important. But if you can get the scriptural verses and get the you know, so Genesis 1, you know it's in there. You can find yourself in, or Galatians 5, you can get yourself in the right proximity. But get the verses in your mind so that you can understand scripture, and God can use that to help you grow in your faith. Okay, so can I ask the boys and girls to come down the front? Because I want to tell you a story this morning. Okay, right. So what's the first thing I'm going to do before I tell you a story? Who can tell me? Sorry? Imagination cream. Right, so get your right hand, the opposite one to your left hand, thumb and forefinger deep in the recess of your pocket, and you should find a little container looking like that. Put that in your left hand, undo the lid, put it somewhere safe, get some of this cream, and put it all over your face, okay? Okay. Becky, give me it. Judith hasn't got any. Can you apply some for Judith? Okay, that's great. Thank you. Jolly good. There we go. Get the lid, put it on nice and tight, and put it back into your pocket. Okay, because you've just applied imagination cream, and imagination cream helps you do what? Imagine, that's right. My very first church in Kidlington, Oxfordshire, a young person said, imaginate. No, I've never forgotten that. It's a great word. It helps you to imaginate. But it helps you to imagine. Okay, because I want to tell you a story. Now, in all the stories I tell involving a certain man, involve Herbert Humphreys, okay? There's a bad character, a villain of the piece, as you will, if you will, okay? And every time I mention his name, we have a response. I'm sure you can remember what that is. Nice and loud, please, okay? If ever I mention the name The Hooded Nose, you say... Jolly good, okay, it's a very good first attempt. It was just an attempt. It didn't quite reach the levels of decibel I want to hear in the church. Let's wake up Witten. There could be people still in bed or some believing, okay, let's get them wondering what on earth's going on in Witten Baptist Church. Let's let them know about this hideous character. If I ever mention the name The Hooded Nose.
Oh no, not the Hooded Nose.
Jolly good, okay. Herbert Humphreys was an ordinary sort of bloke. He was 5'8" in height, 13 stone in weight, and well proportioned around the middle. And it was an ordinary sort of day for an ordinary sort of bloke, and Herbert spent his day doing his job sweeping the streets of London. A lady once asked him, "Don't you ever want to work in an office? After all, it must get very cold and wet out here sweeping the streets of London, especially during the winter." And he said, Work in office? My sleeping keeps me warm, whatever the weather. Besides, being a street sweeper is a great job. I get to keep the streets of London clean. Keeping the pavements free of litter so people don't trip up on rubbish or sip on a banana skin. I get to keep the air fresh by putting all the rotten food into bags. I get to keep the streets of London and London itself clean and fresh. Being a street sweeper is a very special job. Yet although street sweeping was a very active job, Herbert still had enough energy week by week to enjoy his favourite sport, and that was playing the game squash. Especially when it involved trying to beat his squash partner, Luca Mee. Luca Mee was very full of himself. Luca Mee was a man who was focused on himself and wanted always to be the centre of attention. He just loved to tell other people about how a great squash player he was. He liked to be the centre of everyone's conversation. He was tall, handsome, intelligent, and knew it. And so did everyone else who ever met him. Now it was Tuesday night, squash night, and Herbert arrived home, got changed, collected his squash racket, and went out to the sports centre. "Hello, Herbert," greeted Luca as Herbert walked into the street centre doors. "Come in for your usual thrashing." "Hi, Luca. I see your usual self-confident self," replied Herbert. "Oh, no, Herbert. No, not confident, just certain. I can't remember the last time you beat me. Never mind, Herbert. Just play your best and try and give me something to do." Both Luca and Herbert changed into their squash attire and went into one of the courts. And the game began. Around the high-walled court, the little green ball flew, bouncing off ball and racket, wall and racket, wall and racket. But the pace was intense. Sweat had broken out on both their heads. And Herbert was on form. He was playing one of the best games he'd ever played against Luca. So much so that Luca was beginning to get worried. "That was a lucky shot," remarked Luca, as Herbert won yet another point. "Clearly, Lady Luck is on your side today." "Not luck, just practice," countered Herbert. "Unlikely, but we'll see," said Luca. Herbert continued to play well, and his confidence grew more and more, when all of a sudden, the door to the court burst open, and in burst a woman with a very red face and with a shrill voice, and she said, "Gentlemen, gentlemen, haven't you heard the terrible news? It's just been on the radio that the hooded nose, has carried out a giant sneeze attack on the post office tower in London. It's now leaning at a 45 degree angle and threatens to collapse, and hundreds of people are trapped in the tower and can't get down because the structure's all twisted. People are trapped in the tower and people are trapped in the homes beneath. And although the news has been broadcast on the TV and on the radio, Superman hasn't come. He must be away on holiday or something." And having delivered her news, she slammed the door shut and went to another court to tell the inhabitants what was going on in London. "I don't believe it," said Herbert. "Here I am in my first game of squash, almost beating Luca for years. And the post office tower's starting to collapse. It's leaning over on its side. I mean, towers don't lean in this country. This is Britain. This isn't Italy." "Come on, Herbert," taunted Luca. "Come on, carry on playing. Unless you're scared, you might lose." With that, Herbert pulled out of his mind any thought about the post office tower, picked up a little green ball, and hit it towards the far end of the court. And the game continued. While the people in the post office tower were in danger of being squashed, Herbert was playing squash and carried on. The game was hectic. The game got faster and faster and faster, and Luca Mee began to catch up. And Herbert's mind was totally on beating his friend Luca Mee. As they got towards the final point, sweat pouring down both their feet, Herbert had become very, very thirsty. And he said to Luca, says, "Oh, I am thirsty. Can we just stop here? I just need a drink." Luca agrees, it suits me, and I'll put you out of your misery. So Herbert went across to his sports bag, he unzipped it, and took out of it a flask marked soup. He undid the lid, poured the soup into another container, and began to slowly drink it. As he did so, there was a flash of light. There was a puff of smoke, and when the smoke and the mist had cleared, Herbert Humphreys was gone. In his place was Superman, the man of soup, the people's hero, defender of the poor and helpless, fighter of crime and evil, a man who, whenever he drank soup, became supercharged and superpowered. Holy rackets, cried Herbert. What am I doing here playing a game of squash when people are in danger of being squashed? There's no time to lose. I must get to the post office tower quick. Luca looked around for where Herbert had gone and couldn't find him. He says, who are you? Ah, he says, doesn't matter who I am. Herbert gives you the game. And our superhero flew out the door, flew down the corridor, out the main doors, high into the sky. When he finally got to the post office tower, there they were, and they were shouting, help us, Superman, help us! And Superman took a deep breath, and using every ounce of his superpowers, he began to push the post office tower back. And push it back into its natural position, going upright. Thanks, Superman, cried the people inside. Thanks, Superman, cried all the postmen who gathered around the bottom of the GPO tower. Thanks, Superman, we're nearly all squashed. Yes, that's my fault, said Superman. I must have should have come sooner. I was too busy playing around. In an instant, he flew down to the bottom of the tower and began to bring comfort and shake the hands of people standing around the bottom, when out of the corner of his eye, he noticed someone with a very large nose. It was the hooded nose.
Oh, no.
A million curses, said the hooded nose. Superman, you're always sticking your nose into where it's not wanted. No, that's not me, that's you, shouted our hero. It's time we learnt not to stick your nose where it's not wanted. And with that, Superman landed a very large punch right on the nose of the evil hooded nose. That's for endangering the lives of so many people, and that's for ruining my game, said Superman. You know, the Bible says this. In Ephesians 5, 15 to 16, it says this. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. And Paul, the apostle, was writing 2,000 years ago, in the time of the Roman Empire, and all the changes and all the persecutions of the Christian church that were taking place there. And he said that the days were evil. We live in days very similar in many ways to that time 2,000 years ago. The days are still evil in the time in which we live. And because they're evil, we need to be wise. We need to be wise. Jesus never took a day off. We find him in the Bible when he's wandering through Jerusalem during the festivals, times when people normally relax and chill out. There's Jesus wandering the streets of Jerusalem, looking for someone to heal, looking for someone to bless, looking for some life he can touch and bring his light and blessing into. And we too must never have a day off of doing good, of trying to do good. I've told you a story. I'll tell you a story again. Fiona and I were on a holiday when we were at a Bible college in London, and it was in our last year, and someone in our church had paid for us. The lady had a sister who ran a B&B in Cornwall and paid for us to stay there for a week, and it was wonderful. And we went away on a motorbike down to Cornwall. It was in Parampulf, and we stayed there for a week in Parampulf, and we loved Parampulf as a family, but when I was younger, we used to go there as a boy. And went to Parampulf, we stayed in this B&B, and we had a great time for it this week. And on the final day, we got on my motorbike, and we knew it was the final day, we would do something special. It was a Friday. We went down to Bedraven Steps, and we got down on the bike and parked in the car park. And it was a glorious sunny day, and the sun was high in the sky, and we could see the steps going out, and we just started to go to the cliff edge and started to just descend the cliffs, when we saw someone sitting further along on the left-hand side, right on the cliff edge, and he looked a bit dodgy. Dodgy, not in the sense that he was doing anything dodgy, but it looked like he was troubled. And we're at this point, and I thought to myself, my final day of my holiday, I'm holiday father, you know, I want to enjoy the Bodrum Round Steps. But I saw this guy, and he just, there's something in him, and there's a prompting in my heart saying, I need to go and talk to him. So we went across, and we sat with him on the cliff edge for about 4 hours. And he was suicidal. He wanted to throw himself over. And so we began to talk with him and just calm him and just bring him to a point when you know, he could feel able to walk away. And so eventually, that's what he did after about 4 hours. He eventually got off the cliff edge and he walked back towards his home. And by that stage, the light had begun to go down. And it was getting dark. And there was no point going down the steps to explore Budder River Steps because the day had gone. But you don't ever have a day off from doing what God wants you to do. We never have a day off from doing good. And the Bible says this, make most of every opportunity because the days are evil. I couldn't enjoy myself in Bedrock and Steps if I'd gone down to the bottom and looking around and enjoying the cliffs. And all of in the background, I hear someone's falling off the cliff head. You know, I wouldn't have been, it wasn't right. We had to do something because God was telling us, go and speak to that person. And we must be open to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. We never have a day off of doing what God wants us to do. Make the most of every opportunity. That's the first thing about being wise. And we'll be looking at other things about being wise later on in the service. Make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. We're going to sing again now. We're going to sing our offertory hymn, Surely Our God is the God of Gods. Let's stand together.
Revealer of mysteries.
Please take your seats. And we're going to read together now from Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 to 16. Ephesians 5, 1 to 16. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Bible. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you there must be not even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of any greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral person, no immoral, impure or greedy person, such a person is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord, having nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. This is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Thank God for that reading of his holy word. So we're going to turn to my slides, please. Thank you. And I mentioned earlier on that we're looking at the issue of true wisdom, what true wisdom is. We go back to that verse again, Ephesians 5, verses 15 to 16. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. So the first question is, what is wisdom? What is wisdom? Solomon, we're told, was a wise man. What is wisdom? Who can tell me what wisdom is? Go on, Peter. Yeah. Guidance, it can be. Yeah, that's a good answer, actually. Yes, it can be guidance. Okay. Anything particular about guidance you can think of? I mean, if you're given guidance, and what's important about being given guidance? Ah, that's brilliant. Well done. To make good decisions. Okay. Right, so we look at the Oxford definition of wisdom. Oxford's English Dictionary, it says this. The ability or result of an ability to think and act, utilizing knowledge, experience, understanding, common sense, and insight. Or accumulated knowledge, erudition, or enlightenment. Now, there's a key in there about what wisdom is. Can anyone tell me what the key is in the first part of the definition? There's a couple of words that are key to wisdom. No? Yes. Okay, Tom?
Is it the knowledge, experience, and understanding?
It's a good try. You're close. It's a bit before that. Okay. Think about that. We're going to come to it in a moment. Okay. Wisdom. Let me ask you a series of questions. Wisdom. Is wisdom owning lots of books? Only lots of books. Could that be wisdom? Probably get wisdom from books, can't you? If they're good books, of course you get bad books, you don't get wisdom, do you? If you get books that are bad, pretty bad books, Mein Kampf, you know, or you know, the Communist Manifesto, they're not really going to help you in terms of salvation, are they? They're not going to really help you. Not even if you learn to read from a very, very young age. Okay? So books are helpful, but they're not necessarily the key to wisdom. What about this? Having lots of degrees. Okay, we're not talking about being in a pop group. We're talking about those kind of degrees. Scrolls, okay? Having an academic hood. Okay, do you think wisdom's about having lots of degrees? No? Okay. I mean, some of the evidence of that is we've got people in Parliament who've got lots of degrees. Sometimes you really question whether they've got wisdom. But there we go. That's another story. Okay, what about winning at Mastermind? Imagine that, holding the golden globe, or whatever they call that. It's a bit of crystal, isn't it? So, winning at Mastermind, what a great achievement. Do you think that's what it means to be wise? Okay, what about then winning at the chase? That's a tough one, isn't it? You must be pretty clever, aren't you? But would you be wise winning at the chase? Would that mean you're a wise person? I don't know. What about beating the eggheads? Okay? Do you think, is a wise person that beats the eggheads? What's interesting about the definition that we have from the Oxford English Dictionary is this. It doesn't mention about the size of your head, does it? It doesn't say to be wise you've got to have an egghead. It doesn't say anything about intelligence. Not that I can see there, in the sense that it's about being intelligent or being very clever or being someone with lots of degrees. It doesn't mention any of these things at all, does it? It says the ability to think and act. Think and act. You see, some people know a lot, but still are pretty stupid. You know, I remember at Bible Training Institute with Fiona on our graduation in 1985, we had one of the professors who was talking about being a professor. He was talking about wisdom, and he was making the point that actually, just because he had lots of degrees, didn't make him necessarily very wise. And he described how one day he was trying to fix the leaks on his leaking roof with blue tack. Blue tack to fix leaking roofs. And you're thinking, you know, he had lots of degrees. He had a PhD, had lots of degrees, but he actually not necessarily particularly very wise. Wisdom is not about being highly clever. Wisdom is about thinking and acting, having knowledge and putting that knowledge into practice. See, many people know the truth but choose not to live by it. They can have experience of what is right and what is wrong and still live by what is wrong, and that's not wise, is it? They've got the knowledge. So it says here, it's the ability, result of an ability to think and act, utilizing knowledge, making that knowledge part of their behavior. That's what wisdom's about. Wisdom is not merely knowing something, it's putting that knowledge into practice. There's a big question. So I don't know if anyone can answer this, but why do women live longer than men? Why do women live longer than men? Sorry?
Men give up.
Men give up. Okay, that could be, okay. Okay, could be. I've got some slides that can demonstrate for a bit of why this can be. Because men are not always very wise. Men sometimes don't really, they take risks that are a bit stupid. Their behavior perhaps doesn't always demonstrate common sense. I love the way that the dad's got a helmet on and his son doesn't have one on. I mean, good grief, good parenting skills there. Okay, from Russia. Yes, it's probably Russia. Yeah, it's on the way to Ukraine. And what's amazing about this, he's demonstrated, he realizes he needs some protection over his eyes and over his head, but decides to use a plastic see-through bucket. Why women live longer than men? Well, it's because men can be incredibly silly. The more you look at that, if you understand that is just so incredibly stupid. It's just remarkable. I've seen accidents with forklifts, and they don't go well when they turn over, and that is just incredible. Cheap ways of cutting your hedge. There's a man who really trusts his colleagues. Now, the last one, I understand the physics of it. I can understand that hopefully the ladder can't go anywhere else, hopefully. But I wouldn't want to do it. Why women live longer than men? Men are not afraid of heights. And these are just incredible. How to mend your air conditioning unit. That's where they are. And the last couple are just incredible. Look at that. Outside, cleaning his window. Why women live longer than men? Men sometimes just don't get it. I mean, why? Just why? And the last one is just beggar's belief. Wisdom. You've had a series of displays of lack of wisdom. People that are demonstrating the knowledge of health and safety because they're trying to, some of them are trying to wear some kind of health and safety equipment, but actually ultimately they're not being or behaving in a wise manner. And that's true of our society in the modern day in which we live. And I think what's incredible is we live in an age where we recognize degrees and we have honorifics for qualifications at the yin yang. We've got all these qualifications and what have you. And yet we seem to be becoming more and more unwise in our society in which we live. The Bible says, it's a bit of a long verse, but I think it's really important to read this to get to the last bit. The Bible says, the wrath of God has been revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. It's not they don't know the truth, they suppress it. Since what has been made known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. But since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God, nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. And when Paul is writing in Ephesians 5 about the days being evil, this is what he's writing about. We live in an age which actually, when people claim to be wise, claim to be clever, they look back and say, the people in the past got it wrong. 2,000 years, they've had it wrong, and we've finally, eureka moment, we've got it, we understand it better than ever. And they claim to be wise, but the Bible says they have become fools. It's really important to remember this. Now, if I was to shout out right now, the church is on fire, okay, there could be two reactions. You'd either sit in your seats like you are now and look at me, and have a surprised look on your face. Or if you really believed what I was saying, is you get out and you assemble in the assembly area out in the car park. See, knowledge of knowing the church is on fire doesn't protect you from the flames unless you act on the knowledge by removing yourself from the danger. Wisdom is not about knowledge, because the Bible says people know there's a God, they have a conscience that God has given them, yet they choose to suppress the truth and refuse to acknowledge the truth or to show any gratitude towards God. They just go their own way. What they do, in effect, is they become their own gods. And that's what we live. That's why people nowadays talk about my truth. I've told you before, it's a nonsense. Truth can never be yours or mine. Truth is truth. You know, truth is not something that you tell me what is and that I tell you what is. Truth is there. this floor is solid, okay? If you hang from the metal strut up there and let go and land on this hard surface, you're going to break something or hurt something because this is hard and your body is soft. That's not my truth. That's a reality of gravity hitting and you falling and hitting a hard surface. Truth is outside ourselves. Truth is found in God and in His Word. Truth is not about your truth or my truth. It's about knowing what the truth is and living by that truth, and that gives us wisdom. The Bible says this, it says, you believe there's one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. And what James is saying, the brother of Jesus, is saying, but just knowing about God and believing in God is not enough. Because Satan believes in God. And many people claim they know, they believe in God. Yeah, of course I believe in God. That's not enough. Wisdom is acting upon that belief, upon the truth of that belief. Otherwise, Satan will be a Christian. Satan believes in God. He rebelled against God. That belief doesn't save Satan. It just further condemns him, because God is truth and is a knowledge. The Bible says elsewhere, this we read earlier on, the fool says in his heart there is no God. The fool says in his heart, ultimate wisdom is actually acknowledging the existence of God and living by that wisdom. And it's liberating. It is absolutely liberating. Because finally your choices are reduced. You know, one of the most difficult things, coming back from when you've been on operations in the war zone in the military, is coming back when you've been going into a little shop. If you're lucky, if you're on a FOB, you haven't got any shops, but you're in a main base, you can go along to a shop called the NAFI. And we have NAFIs out wherever the military operate. And you there have a choice of probably one or two. You know, Heinz baked beans or Co-op baked beans, and that's your choice. And it's wonderful, because if you want baked beans, there they are. Just two cans of baked beans. If you go to the Asda up the road, you want a can of baked beans, you could be there for half an hour with salted and non-salted, with, you know, do you want it in this particular brand or this particular brand, an expensive brand or a cheap brand, and all different varieties of baked beans, and you think, I just want a can of baked beans. How did life get so complicated? And as a Christian, the great thing about true wisdom of believing and following the Word of God is that God simply says, you haven't got those choices. This is the right way. If you're not going the right way, you're going the wrong way. And that's actually wonderfully liberating in our world that seeks to make life more and more complicated. And we see this in our society now, that's even trying to tell you that there's more than one gender. And boys and girls, you may have in school people telling you that there's more than one gender. Stonewall, for example, tries to claim there's over 100 different genders. That is stupid. That is foolish. The Bible says, in becoming wise, they have become fools. The Bible made it quite clear in the verse that we read earlier on, in Genesis. It says there at the end, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. You know, it's incredible. We look at look at the animal world. They're not confused over what gender they are. We've got a dog at home. He's a male dog. He's not worried about whether he's a female dog or a male dog. He knows he's a male dog. He demonstrates it in his behavior every day. We confuse ourselves in our society because we claim to be wiser than we really are. And we claim to be truth rather than no truth. One of the verses we heard earlier on, John 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He brings clarity to our lives because he tells us what the real truth is. That's why the Bible tells us this. That's why the Bible says, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. And we have the truth in God's word, the Bible. And it really helps to clarify things. It helps us know the difference between right and wrong and the way to go. And there are parts in the Bible that are very difficult to understand. Fiona and I are reading through Revelation right now as part of our daily quiet time. And that's difficult to understand, but other books are really simple. And Genesis is one of those quite simple books where we're told quite simply that we're made in God's image and made male and female. It's not complicated unless we choose to make it complicated. Make the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Wisdom. What is wisdom? Wisdom is living by the word of God. Wisdom is learning to listen to God day by day, to pray and spend time with him, but not just listening to him, but doing what he says. Wisdom is not about having an egghead, a big brain. It's not about having lots of degrees, although it's good if you can, when you're at school, to study and to work as hard as you can, to go as far as you can. It's not about that. Wisdom is about knowing and doing, putting into practice the good things you know are right and proper, the Bible tells us to do. That's wisdom. That's why the Bible says that God uses the foolish to shame the strong. You know, being a Christian is not about being terribly bright or terribly intelligent. It's about being wise. It's about knowing the truth and living it. That's how each one of us can be a wise person, a person who can shine with the light that Christ wants to give us through his truth. Let's bow our heads and speak to the Lord. Lord, we live in a world that's so incredibly complex and makes life so difficult, offers decisions and choices for people that don't exist, but is confusing lots of young people right now and causing a mental health crisis we've never seen the likes of in our world. Lord, we pray for the world in which we live. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you may bring your truth and your wisdom to this place. Bring your truth and your wisdom to our schools, to our governments, that our governments will stand up for common sense and won't allow themselves to be swept in the direction of minority pressure groups simply because it's PC or because it's seen as being something that is fashionable. Lord, we pray you may anchor us in your word. Anchor us in truth. Lord Jesus, anchor us in yourself. Help us, Lord, day by day to have the joy of talking to you, of reading your word, the Bible, of spending time in your presence, of knowing the wonder of talking to the living God. Lord Jesus, of following you day by day and hearing you and being challenged and prompted by you in our lives. Give us that joy. May we each one enjoy that dynamic relationship with you. We may grow closer to you, Lord Jesus, and grow in our wisdom as we learn to put your word into practice day by day in our lives. Lord Jesus, make us wise and make us glorify you. We ask, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen. Let's stand and sing our closing hymn by Stuart Townend, The Perfect Wisdom of Our God.
It's the words are beautiful, but we thought we would sing the first verse through to you, and then if you'd like to stand and sing, we'll start the hymn again. Please follow the words if you know it.
Wisdom of our God, revealed to all the universe. All things created by his hand and held together at his command. He knows the mysteries of the sea, of the stars are his. He guides the planets on their way and turns the earth through another day.
Please stand to sing.
Though wisdom of our God, revealed to all the universe. All things created by His hands and held together at His command. He knows the mysteries of the sea.
David, could you put on the second to last slide, please? And the one before that? That's great, thank you. This is our prayer as we close the service now. Before we enjoy fellowship and coffee, let's just say these words again together. The matchless wisdom of His ways that mark the path of righteousness. His word a lamp unto my feet. His spirit teaching and guiding me. And oh, the mystery of the cross, that God should suffer from the lost, so that the fool might shame the wise, and all the glory might go to Christ. Amen.
righteousness is what a lamp unto my feet, his spirit.